Let's finish up this project. After marking a line 2 cm from the bottom section of the LED panel with a scriber, it was finally time to mount the LED strips. For that, I created shorter pieces of the strip, which contains of 15 LEDs each, and repeated this cutting procedure until I got a total of 13 shorter strips. Only problem was that the emitted light of the pure white LEDs was a bit too cold for my taste. So I created an equal amount of shorter 1 white 5630 LED strips, which will balance out the overall color temperature decently. To mount these strips in the middle of the panel, I mount the 6.5 cm spot from the left and right side onto the previously created line, and I peeled the protective tape of the adhesive in order to secure the first pure white LED strip along the marked line. The following LED strip was then warm white, and the following again cold white, and so on and so on. The only thing that bothered me while mounting the LED strips was that due to their rather poor quality, some had unpleasant bumps which were pretty much unremovable. But nevertheless, after securing the last LED strip near the top section of the panel, I marked a line in the top left and right corner 1 cm beneath the upper flat bar limits and got myself 12 of those cable mounts. Due to their adhesive backside, it was easy to stick 6 of them evenly distributed on the left side of the plates in level with the warm white LEDs. On the right side though, I also stuck 6 of them evenly distributed, but this time in level with the cold white LEDs. And after drilling 2 3.5mm holes according to the previously created lines above the cable mounts in the left and right corner, it was time to remove the insulation of a 3-meter long, 3x2.5mm stiff wire. I used 1.5m of the brown and blue wire on each side and pushed it from the back through the created holes all the way down to the lowest cable mount. Then I used my wire stripper to remove the insulation of the 4 wires and secured them afterwards to the cable mounts with zip ties and a bit of hot glue. Next, I pre-tinned the solder pads of the pure white LED strip on the left side and the solder pads of the warm white LED strips on the right side. Through the help of thinner 0.75mm wire, I connected all plus pads to the thicker brown wires and all minus pads to the thicker blue wires. But keep in mind that the pure white solder connections are all located on the left side and the warm white connections are all on the right side. During the soldering process, I also regularly tested the LED strips with a 12-volt power source, and once the soldering was complete, I was able to power all the LEDs through the 4 wires from the back of the panel. That means it was time for the control electronics. Now, of course, we could use an Arduino in combination with a potentiometer and a MOSFET in order to turn on and off the LED strip rapidly and thus dim its brightness. But you can already see a common problem with such a circuit. By utilizing the predefined PWM frequency of the Arduino, which is around 490 Hz, a noticeable flicker is captured by my camera. To fix this, we could change the PWM frequency of the Arduino up to 3.9 kHz, which gets rid of all the flicker. But we could also scrap the microcontroller part completely and simply use the classical 555 timer IC instead. By creating an astable multivibrator circuit with it, we can create a PWM signal with a variable duty cycle between 0% and almost 100% at a frequency of 25 kHz. This signal is then fed into a TC4420 MOSFET driver IC, which controls the gate of an IRLZ44N MOSFET and thus ultimately controls the LED strip. At a constant voltage of 12 volts, this circuit draws around 3 amps at 100% brightness of the pure white and warm white LED strips. But since my targeted portable energy source, aka a lithium ion battery pack, which I created in a previous project video, has a voltage range of 12.6 volts down to 9 volts, it would slowly decrease the brightness of the LEDs. So we need a powerful buck boost converter whose input connects to the battery in order to create a stable 12 volt output, no matter whether the input voltage is higher or lower than 12 volts. And for safety reason, we also need one of those LiPo battery voltage tester. By connecting the balance outputs of the lithium ion battery to it, it monitors the voltage of each cell constantly and creates a loud beeping sound when one of them reaches a voltage of 3 volts, since that is the moment you need to recharge your battery pack. To complete the circuit, all that was left was a double pole double throw switch, which interrupts and connects the ground potential of the battery to the buck boost converter and the ground wire of the balance connector to the monitor circuit. Now, of course, one 555 timer circuit with MOSFETs is not enough for two LED colors. So I created a 7x5.5cm piece of perf board with copper dots, gathered the required components for two 555 timer circuits, and soldered all of them onto the perf board. According to my created schematic of the finalized circuits, I connected the components to one another. And of course, you can find the schematic along with other useful information in the video description. Once the soldering procedure was complete, I used the component and screw hole markings on the perf board that I created beforehand to design an appropriate case for the electronics in 1-2-3D design. After a print duration of roughly 8 hours in total, the printed case looked decent, but definitely had some warping problems. But nevertheless, after removing all the support material, this circuit did fit decently. So I added the appropriate sockets to my lithium ion battery, pushed them into the new housing, and secured them with 2 component adhesive. After the glue was dry, I added the remaining components to the perf board, soldered wires and male headers to 2 potentiometers, hooked up the LED wires to the terminals, and connected the power circuitry in order to test the completed circuit one last time. Since it worked like a charm, I soldered appropriate wires to the switch and voltage tester, connected them to the XT60 connector and balance connector, and then mounted them along with the potentiometers onto the case with nuts and a bit of hot glue. Then I secured the control circuit in the top section of the board and the buck boost converter right underneath it. To finish this project, I used 3 strips of Velcro tape on the backside of the battery and control housing to mount it to the backside of the LED panel, shorted the LED wires, secured them to the PCB terminals, gave the whole thing labels, and closed the housing with its lid. The following battery test was, as you can see, a clear success. But you can always scrap the battery part and directly connect a 12 volt power source to the DC jack. The buck boost converter does not mind that. Now I will use my LED panel in the future to film a solar project in my garage, since there's wiring, a switch, a socket and a light installed, but simply no electrical power available. I hope you liked this project. If so, don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Consider supporting me through Patreon to keep such videos coming. Stay creative, and I will see you next time.